do what I need to do so that I can make a scrapbook for Parker Webb. Good evening. I'd like to call the school committee to order. This is our March 21st, 2016 meeting. Our chair, Mr. Robinson, I believe will be joining us later this evening, but he isn't here at the outset. We have a really kind of exciting meeting tonight. I'm excited about it. We'll start with public comment the way we always do. We do have a consent agenda. We'll move into reports. And then we're going to hear a presentation about maker spaces throughout the district. And I think we have representatives from the elementary, middle, and high school level. So that's going to be very interesting. We have a collaborative agreement amendment to approve. And then I think we're going to wrap up with Friends and Family Day. So I'll start by public comment. Is there anybody who came for public comment this evening for any items not on the agenda?
Can I just inquire about a donation to the high school library? Did you get a check from PTO?
Let me see.
Yes, it's in the consent agenda.
It's in the consent agenda. Did you have a specific question about it or just wanted to ensure it was included?
I just wanted to make sure.
It was included. Okay, yeah. Any other questions? Okay, seeing none, we will move into the consent agenda. Tonight we are accepting donations to Reading Memorial High School, a donation to Wood End, we're approving a field trip, and we have minutes dated March 7th. Does anybody on the committee want to remove anything from the consent agenda?
No.
All right, do I have a motion?
Move to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Second.
All those in favor? 5-0. All right, reports. Alex, what's going on at the high school?
So spring sports tryouts have started today. It was crazy with the snow and everybody was stuck in the field house. Also, the robotics team came in fourth place at the competition. I think it was 2 weekends ago. Mm-hmm. There was a dodgeball tournament last week. The sophomore semi was on Saturday night. And the bells are still broken at the high school, but every day we hear Mrs. O'Rourke slash the bell, announce when to move to the periods. So that's it.
Very good. Anyone on the committee have reports tonight?
I do, actually. I wanted to report that the AWOD group went to the Youth Congress this week, last Friday. And from what I'm hearing, they had a great time, thanks to the funders, the different funders of that group. Also, Lily Midnight, Jason Cross, and I went to the Metco Lobby Day on last Tuesday, and that was exciting. There were lots of people talking about the benefits of the program, and we were able to visit the offices of Representative Jim Dwyer's, Bradley Jones, and also Senator Lewis's office, and that was... They were very supportive and have been very supportive of the program, so that was very worthwhile to go. And I wanted to make it a point to show the CPAC. They not only have gotten their bylaws written in a short period of time, they've also got a newsletter started. They also just had a meeting. I didn't realize that Ms. Wilson wouldn't be here, so I'm not prepared to report on the whole meeting. I wasn't able to attend, and it sounded packed, both from the discussions that went on and the plans that they're making. So check out their headline page for more specific information.
It's been really nice to see that group reforming and re-energized.
Yes. Yeah, exactly.
Anything
Thank
else?
You. That's good.
Nothing
Thank you.
Is Dr. Darty, your report's going to include some of the information about the behavioral health? It isn't? Okay, well... I guess I got to only briefly look at these, but I just wanted to highlight the work that I think you and Sarah Bird have been doing is just amazing. And the fact that that work is recognized at the Department of Education level and then going to be presented at the conferences shows just, I think, a level of leadership that just speaks to how much people in our district put into their work of themselves on behalf of the students. And so I just wanted to highlight that, and I don't know if those are going to be on Edline or for people to read.
We can put them. Well, the state report is on the DESE website.
Mm-hmm.
The MASS report, we can certainly put on Edline, sure.
Okay. And I think sort of aligned with that, I just wanted to say I'm attending through RACASA the Youth Mental Health First Aid, which, I don't know, over 500, I think, district staff and teachers and community department heads and have attended, and I really appreciate that. It's a great group of people from all different parts of the community, different age people that they might be concerned about, not just, you know, youth. And so I think it's a great class. I highly recommend it. It's three sessions, 2 hours each week, three consecutive Wednesdays. So I wanted to just highlight that and really some of the work that RACASA has done. So I've been on that board as a parent member. Chuck is technically the school committee liaison. And I think that when you look at the kinds of things that RACASA brings to the community, there's also an event tonight in Wakefield on around mental health issues for college students. And, you know, unfortunately, there was a terrible death, actually, in UDEL, I think in the last few days. And I think it's just so important that, you know, students and parents understand and take advantage of these great resources to educate yourself and give yourself the resources to be able to support your students. I think like Linda, some of my kids are further away, and it's hard because we've helicoptered them to death while they've been here with us, and, you know, then their two plane flights are 20 hours away, and when they get in distress, you need to be able to have skills and resources. And so I think some of these things that we're doing in the district that will improve the protective assets that students have and can take with them, and then the opportunities that we have as parents and community members to partake of a whole variety of, you know, self-help, self-education. So I just want to highlight that. There's the what's the other piece? There's the youth mental health first aid and
Active parenting.
That's what I'm saying. So I just highly recommend that people take a look at this amazing amount of resources.
And that's really true. And I think that, just to piggyback off what you said, Reading really is a leader in social emotional learning. And you made me think of it. The Mass Associations of School Committee is putting together a task force of school committee members from across the state to advocate for social emotional learning to be more prominent in all districts. And I've actually volunteered to serve on that task force.
Oh, excellent.
So, but it's easy coming from Reading, because we've already done a lot of good work in this area. So, so I agree.
Thank you.
There is an adult mental health first aid class that's starting, I think it's just a Saturday.
It's
this coming Saturday. And I don't know if they have space left, but I'm signed up for that.
I think they do.
And I'm very excited to be taking part in that.
All right, any other reports from the committee? Okay, Dr. Doherty and Mr. Martin.
I think Craig has. Yeah, just very quickly, I kind of want to give a plug for tomorrow evening, if we're live and people are watching out there in the public. We have Professor Mahesh Sharma coming tomorrow night, and it's fresh in my mind because we were actually with him today. The PD that he's been doing with our district has just been outstanding, and I'm hearing from teachers every day. Today he was a guest teacher in a couple of our classrooms, in a grade one class and a grade two class, which gives the teachers a chance then to talk with him afterwards about some of the strategies and techniques. He really is helping us all understand sort of the developmental continuum that children go through and reaching certain mathematical milestones in their development. And that's sort of what he's gonna be talking about tomorrow night. We're really thrilled to have him. His presentation or talk is called How Children Learn Math. Mm-hmm. And he's worked with so many different districts. I think he's told me he's worked in 75 different countries around the world. Really seen as an expert, and so it's just, we're thrilled to have him, and I hope people are able to come tomorrow night.
Will that be videotaped?
I don't think it is tomorrow night.
Oh,
no,
that's too bad.
That's really a shame.
Check into that, but yeah, I don't think we've arranged.
Yeah, that. There's a lot of parental interest in the community about math education.
Yep.
That's great.
I have a whole bunch of things.
All right. We'll settle in.
Not the thing I mentioned, but a whole bunch.
No, I never even thought about that. So first I want to start, I do want to piggyback on what Alex said about the robotics team. And as you know, 2 weekends ago, we had the North Shore District Competition here at Reading Memorial High School, which was very well attended by hundreds of people all over New England. We had 40 teams, high school teams, from every state in New England. And as Alex had said, the preliminary rounds, Reading did very well, ranked fourth out of the 40 teams. They then entered the elimination round and reached the semifinals, which that in itself is a pretty prestigious accomplishment. However, in addition to how you do with the robot, there are a lot of other awards that are connected to outside of the robot, in which focus on ranging from the team spirit all the way to rookie of the year to everything in between, the quality of the robot. But there is the award called the Chairman's Award. And the Chairman's Award is the top award that you can get in New England First Robotics competitions. And it is really an award that is a well-rounded award. You have to have a business plan. You have to do a taped interview with members of the community. You have to show how you reach out to the community. It really emulates and embodies the purpose and the goals of what First Robotics is all about. And Reading won it, which is you know, in its fourth year, is an amazing achievement. What that means is that they get to now go to the district competition by winning that award. They do have another regional competition this weekend, but the district competition is in April. And if they do well in that competition, they get to go to the Worlds in St. Louis later on in April. So that's a pretty prestigious award. So again, congratulations to. We're trying to get the robotics team to come at either the next school committee meeting or the school committee meeting after that to talk more about what they did. I want to update the community on the two searches that we've been doing. First of all, the Parker search. As most people know by now, we're pleased to announce that Rochelle Shanklin is going to be the next principal at Parker Middle School. Ms. Shanklin is currently the assistant principal at Linfield Middle School, and she's been there for 16 years in a variety of roles, ranging from mathematics teacher, mathematics department head, and currently she's the assistant principal there. So she will begin as principal at Parker on July 1st, but she's already begun her transition with the current Parker administration. So I know that she's going to be spending the day there on Friday with the school, because Linfield doesn't have school on Friday. So it's giving her an opportunity to spend some time there. And we've already had numerous conversations with her, and I know she's had conversations already with Jane and Brendan. So we certainly welcome her to the Reading Public Schools. Birch Meadow, we currently have three finalists, as I announced via ConnectEd this week. Patricia Beckman, who's currently the associate principal at Birch Meadow, Julia Hendricks, who's the assistant principal at the Harrington Elementary School in Lexington, and Gregory Irvin, who is the principal of the Mindus Elementary School in Ashland. This week, we're going to be going on some site visits for the finalists, and my hope is that I'll be making an appointment either at the end of next week or the beginning of the following week. So that's where we are on the two searches. Moving right along to some other good news. Last year, we had a student at the high school that won the Alliance for Young Artists and Writers National Award. And it was for a painting, which then was shown in Carnegie Hall in June. And this year, we actually have some high school and middle school winners. This is sponsored by Scholastic. It's called the Scholastic Art and Writing Awards. It's the nation's longest running and most prestigious recognition program for creative teens in grades 7 through 12. Only the top 1% are recognized at the national level for their work. So we have currently four students that were recognized: Samantha Broussard, who's a 12th grade student. She had a photograph called Dad. Amy Cassavant, who is a junior, for her painting called Fried Egg. Abby Frechette, who is an 8th grade student at Coolidge, for her painting called Moose. Lily Johnson, who is also an 8th grade student at Coolidge, for her poem Raven Crate. And if you want to know what these pictures and or poem look like, you can go onto my blog, and it's all on there on the newsletter for this week. So congratulations to those students. They're going to all be going to Carnegie Hall in June to see their work in New York City. So, and you know, really kudos also to their teachers, Kathleen Daly, Veronique Latimer at the high school, the art teachers, and Coolidge art teacher Sarah Doan and Coolidge language arts teacher Laura Warren. Those are the teachers for those students. More good news. Saturday, the high school jazz band, under the direction of Joe Mulligan, competed in the Massachusetts Association of Jazz Educators State Jazz Band Finals at Norwood High School. I am pleased to announce that they earned a gold medal for the three songs that they played. They competed with bands from all over Massachusetts. Because of this recognition, they get to perform at the Hatch Shell in May, May 15th, on the Charles River. So congratulations to the jazz band. And finally, congratulations to the high school winter color guard, who this past weekend placed second in the NESBA, New England School Band Association, Triton competition. Last week, and then third this week at the NESBA Color Guard Show in Mansfield. And then they're performing in the finals next Saturday at Salem High School. So we wish them the best of luck in that. A lot of good things going on. I do have one more thing that we talked about at the Finance Committee meeting the other night. It was a question that came up, I believe, by Mr. Robinson. Because I know there was some conversation about per pupil, and we had showed you a slide with the per pupil, where we ranked among the 30 comparable communities that the town and the schools use. So when you look at the total per pupil, as we mentioned at the meeting the other night, Reading was ranked 29th. Out of the 30 communities and per pupil. We also showed you what would happen if we took out transportation, because we do have less bus transportation than a lot of communities. Reading would be ranked in per pupil 25th out of 30 communities. A question came up about health insurance. So the way that the Department of Education looks at health insurance is there's a category called fixed charges. And fixed charges takes a look at benefits, health insurance, and some other types of costs, such as crossing guards, which I have no idea why crossing guards were being included in that. But when you take out the fixed charges minus the transportation, so the transportation is still in there. Reading's ranking is 28th out of 30 communities. When you take out both fixed charges and transportation, Reading is ranked 26th out of 30 communities. So I know that question came up. I wanted to make sure that we provided the answer, not only for the school committee, but for the community, because I know that's come up in the past. Because we may have less busing, or because perhaps our health insurance may be more paid in Reading, more of a percentage is paid by the employee instead of the employer, I wanted to capture what still would our per pupil be. So you can see it still is at the bottom third of the 30 comparable communities, even when you take those out.
I think this is a really good exercise to go through. Because of those questions that come up, and it's just a good intellectual exercise to do, to say, well, what about this? What about that? It's really good.
We are restricted a little bit by what DESE has for their categories, but I think it does give us a pretty good
I was going to throw out another restriction is this is 2013 to 14 data. So it is a couple of years old.
Right, it's the, but it's the last data that we have
exactly,
right now.
Exactly, that's what DESE can give us. So I would, right. I would just sort of, anyone looking at these numbers, understand that there could be some changes. But yeah, it's the best that they've got.
Do we not have our own per pupil though for 14, 15 or no? This is the latest that
no,
we have.
No, we have ours up, right. Yeah, because we have to file the end of, our end of the year report has been filed.
But this is just in terms of being able to get the comparable communities and
correct.
Get all the data. So I think, if it's okay, these questions have come up year over year every mm-hmm. time we try to talk about. So I think this is, you know, it's just really informative. And I think one of the healthcare is one of the areas where I think people, you know, would say, well, if, you know, if we're, if employees are carrying more of a burden and, you know, or we're paying more in healthcare than other communities, you know, how do we know if you don't take that out? And I think this is great because it answers that question. One thing I guess I would say is while we don't have the other communities, we know where ours is in the same range, I believe, for 2014-15, right? I'd have to actually look
right,
at that.
Right, but where we don't have the per pupil expenditure for the other communities, we can't do that comparison.
Right. I think, though, you look at what the trend is, you know, you look at our trend line in terms of the gap against the state level, it didn't change. It's continuing on that same trend of increasing the gap. So I appreciate it. What was the tool?
It's called Edwin Analytics.
Was that something that the DESE had, or is it a tool that we have, or something Martha just came up
no,
with?
No, we have access to that tool.
Oh, okay.
It's not on their public website, but we have access to it through Edwin, which is a tool that administrators have access to.
Oh, okay. To look at data. Okay. Great.
It's a state, yeah, it's a state tool.
Mm-hmm.
That's
Thank
it.
You. This is, I really do think this was very helpful. Thank you. You know, it struck me while you were talking about all of the successes, what's interesting is it's in so many different areas.
Yes.
Whether you're an athlete or a musician or an artist or a writer or an engineer, you know, I feel like we are a system where any kid can find a place to shine, and it certainly has been a good news couple of weeks for a lot of our students. Were there any other reports that I'm unaware of?
That was it for me.
I wanted to mention Parker's musical, which was The Lion King. It was absolutely fabulous. I was fortunate enough to bring, I have 4 and a 5-year-old with me, so I got to see it through their eyes as well as mine, and they were mesmerized the entire time, as was I. The colors, the singing, the harmonies, the complicated harmonies, and they weren't even in English. It was just so impressive, and they looked like such a cohesive cast. I just wanted to do a shout out to all of the staff and the students that worked on that play. It just bowled me over. It was wonderful. Thank you.
Oh, there were two other things I forgot to mention, which you had reminded me to mention. Tomorrow evening.
Yes. Yes.
I wrote them down.
This is actually important. Yeah.
Tomorrow evening, the Board of Selectmen will be having their meeting beginning at 7:00. School committee will also be posted for that meeting. Our town legal counsel will be doing a presentation on the conflict of interest and ethics piece of an override election. So that's obviously going to be a very what we can do, what we can't do, once it becomes a vote of the selectmen in for a ballot question. And then Wednesday night, the Finance Committee will be voting on all of the town budgets, including the school department budget. And that starts at 7:30. I think that's at the Senior Center. I'll have to check. I believe it's still at the Senior Center.
It weren't shown last time.
Last week, Dr. Doherty and Ms. Seibert did a very, very nice job of presenting our budget to the Finance Committee. They had really mm-hmm. solid questions. It was a good discussion. So that vote will be good. Do we have an executive session at 6 tomorrow?
No, it's not an executive session.
Oh, it starts at 7?
Yeah.
Oh, then I apologize.
No, that's
I'm
just
glad I clarified that. I would have showed up an hour early. All right. Okay. So shall we hear about makerspaces?
Absolutely.
Great.
Just as a short intro, The Library Media Specialists Professional Learning Community has been working on this goal all year. You may have noticed in the newsletters that I've been sending out that there have been several examples of how makerspaces are being used at each level, and tonight it's going to be come alive at each level. So we have several of our library media specialists here this evening to present it to you. I think you're going to really enjoy this.
Thank you. So first we want to introduce ourselves. There is representation from all three levels. So Kim Adamo is from Helen Elementary School. I'm Lisa Norcross. I'm from Wood End. Robin Farazani is over at Parker. And then Shane Burke over there is at the high school level. So we are representing all of us, that not everyone could make it tonight, and we didn't want to bombard you with all nine of us. But everyone added in a little bit to the presentation, and we're sharing on what all of us have done. And like Dr. Doherty said, we started this about a year ago, the process of getting into makerspaces. It's kind of been an upcoming wave for a while in libraries, both public and in universities and other places as well. So we kind of took it on as a team and developed it from there. Add this a little bit.
Oh, sure. So a makerspace can look different wherever you have it. It's wherever it is. It's basically a hands-on, you know, do-it-yourself type of environment where the kids can really get their creative juices flowing and build and create and using sort of project-based learning. So I have a website that it's Killam Makerspace blog, and I have pictures of the kids using the makerspace just to give you an idea of what a makerspace looks like and how the kids use it. It's right here. And all of us have different versions or variations of makerspaces in our libraries, but we're all using them relatively the same way. So at Killam, we use it during book checkout time. Kids can earn extra time to use the makerspace. They really enjoy it. Research shows that kids actually come back to class calmer if they spend a little time building. So this in our makerspace is a combination of, you know, design books. Those were drawing books. It's shelving that was nice enough to be donated by the high school. Everything in our makerspace was donated either by parents or teachers. So it's different shelving. We have geoboards, tangrams. Here are kids using math blocks, and they're stacking them together to make different designs. And those are actually fifth graders. These are fifth graders using the geoboards. So I basically just leave the stuff there, and I kind of let them come up with how they use it. They made a design using the tangrams, and they're always working together, which I love. Here they're balancing things on the scales. So that'll give you a general idea of what we're talking about and what a makerspace looks like.
We started, as I said, like about a year ago with this, and the first thing that we did is through School Library Journal, they were promoting a class on makerspace, and we brought it up at a PLC meeting, and we're lucky to get funding from the district to actually have all nine of us be part of it online. So that got us started with some, they gave us some starter kits. We got Makey Makeys, which you'll see a little bit more of in a little bit, but they basically are circuits that allow you to turn everyday things into something that can make music. So kids used bananas and made like musical instruments out of them. They were tapping on different pieces of paper, and music can come out of that too. So it's kind of a neat way for them to start to explore different pieces of technology together. Then as we were working together throughout the year, we started to make plans of how can we help identify what our spaces could look like, how can we use what we have, and really doing it without a budget. We didn't want to have to put a whole lot of money into it, and we didn't have a lot of money to put into it. The idea of a makerspace is really reusing and being creative with what you have, and that's exactly what we did to develop our makerspaces. We also went into, this year we put in an REF grant. Each level did it together for items that can support our makerspace that we would need money for. So we put things in for robotics, mostly at elementary level, and I'll let Sharon and Robin kind of touch upon theirs a little bit more, but you think that's one of the guys we put in for.
So this is a MIP robot that we used at Killam during our Hour of Code to try and teach coding and programming to younger kids. So he can move using various hand signals, and you can also sync him to an iPad.
and the kids really liked it. So you can teach them to come by using the appropriate hand signals. And it's an easier way to kind of teach kids programming when they're, you know, still developing their reading skills and might have a harder time doing it on a computer.
So Kim's children and her niece were lucky to let us use those during her coding, but after using them in her library, we thought it could be something good that all of us could use. So that's one way to bring coding in. It also does emotional. They can feel, make different feelings, the robot kind of feelings. But that also brings in our open circle curriculum as well. So it kind of brought everything together pretty nicely. Lately, most recently, we've been visiting makerspaces at other schools. We took a trip over to Linfield, and we visited their high school, and we visited Summer Street, mm-hmm. Summer Street Elementary School as well. And we got to see what their makerspaces look like. And two of them were actually presenting with Kim and I at Blue Ribbon. So we're bringing them into our district as well to share a little bit of what they're doing. And oh, we jumped ahead. Yeah, that's what we're doing. We're doing Blue Ribbon. So what does it look like? And really, this was a question that at first, before we really got into it, all of us were a little bit stuck on. We already have our libraries designed. We have lots of big desks and bookcases everywhere. So how can you make a makerspace where they can just create in it? And the answer was any way that we want to. There really isn't a right or wrong. There was, in looking in research and checking out what other schools are doing, it could be as simple as having a cart that you can push from classroom to classroom. It could be bins that someone can just take with them and use. Or it could be other shelves and things that you have. So I know in my case, I did a lot of shopping at the end of the year when everyone's getting rid of all the stuff in their classroom. So I know the picture's a little bit dark, but over here, there's all these bins that people thought were trash, and they now hold all of our great stuff that was left over and that the kids are really enjoying to use. So no cost, donations and things like that. We put books in that area, so there's a lot of like sticky fingers, which is all about duct tape. The kids love making anything out of duct tape, so we have wallets and pens and all that kind of stuff is out there. And then like Kim said, she reused from the high school, and then some of the other schools are using it more like little stations and different tables in the library. So if you're done book borrowing, you can go over there. And then just looking at elementary school a little bit more specifically, so you get an idea what we do. It is a little different at each school, depending on our space and just the way the classes work with your rotation for the librarians. What I do at my school is we offer it for an after-school class. So I do a mini maker, which is K to 2, and I do just regular maker space, which is 3 to 5. And I do it after school. I did 2 sessions so far, and I have another one coming up for the spring session 2. We do some take-home challenges that Kim and I will both tell you a little bit more about. Then we also have just areas that are open during book borrow. I recently opened a cup stacking station after seeing in Linfield how popular hers was. And you would think I gave the kids gold. Like, even the fifth graders were like freaking out that we can really stack cups, that's okay. And just them problem solving, like the cups weren't even. Like, Mr. Crosser, cups you gave us aren't even. So I'm like, how can you fix it? So then they sat there and like leveled them out and saw which ones they could put on which layer. First they were taking it like you were stealing mine, and then they realized that if they share them, the structure gets taller, it gets more supported. So it really was a lot of problem solving with you having to take a step back. And as librarians, we're usually very neat and organized, so it can be a little hard to step back and let them make a mess, but that's really where the creation comes from. And then I also tie in our core values, which I'll show you in just a moment. So I use the makerspace as a way to reinforce our core values, which is part of MTSS, so you're talking about social, emotional. The district is spending a lot of time and funding to develop MTSS more at each school. So one of the things that every school has been working on is developing core values in their buildings. So what I do is at the end of each class, if we showed all of our core values, the students rate themselves as a class. And honesty is one of our core values, so they have to show their honesty. And if they think that they showed all those core values during library time, they can earn a Wildcat, which is Wooden's Wildcat. After they earn 10 of them, they can choose a special day. And Makerspace is one of the options, and it has been picked constantly for all different grade levels. And once one class does it, they tell the other classes, and they're like, they really let you do this during library, it's great. So they really love it. And what's also neat is the pairings of kids is not your typical. So you might always go with a certain friend automatically, and in this, it was really driven by what they were interested in. So girls were over there making catapults with boys and shooting cotton balls across the library, and boys were over making bracelets, and there was no right or wrong. And it was very fluid, you could move through as you wanted. But the kids loved it, and it was just neat to see them be engaged on interest, not because somebody, you know, told you to do something. It was just really neat to see that how their groups were made. Then this is just a couple pictures of my after-school fun. These guys are my little guys over there. So we made robots out of
any kind of boxes and paper and duct tape that you could have. Some of them were bigger than I think the kids are. So they had that one. And this is the Makey Makeys. You can kind of see in here all the different circuits you can make. And these boys are using two bananas as their musical instruments. But the neat thing is they combined the two kits and made one. So all the kids had multiple ones, and it was like a master instrument with like six kids playing it at once. So that was really neat, because I don't even think I knew how to do all that, and they just kind of kept playing with it and going for it. This is from, I don't know if this was at, I think it was Birch Meadow. So Birch Meadow, we all do MCBA books every year. We promote it for our fourth and fifth grade readers. And at Birch Meadow, she tied her makerspace into MCBA, and the kids got to create their own MCBA book covers, and they could make them any way that they wanted to, any kind of media that they wanted to. So she brought that in. So Rump has to do with Rumpelstiltskin, and they have their different materials going all the way through it. So another way to be creative and kind of think outside the box. This is probably my favorite so far. So we have been extending, trying to think of how can you extend the makerspace from just the library to home, because sometimes they go home saying it and the parents have no idea what they're talking about. What is a makerspace? So we've sent out some inner newsletters, we've highlighted it. We've sent out requests for supplies and explained a little bit more. But this was most recent for my school. We did Read Across America the first 2 weeks in March. And our theme this year was Knights and Castles. We have fifth graders that developed a Sir Read-A-Lot character who was a knight. So the challenge was to design Sir Read-A-Lot's castle. And they could use any materials they wanted to. It had to be student designed and created. We had to go over what it means. Your parent can help you glue, but not design the whole thing for you. But really, they did all kinds of things. I had ones made out of marshmallows and sugar cubes with frosting, which that corner of the library smells amazing. There were Legos. There were so many things out of different cardboard materials that I wouldn't have thought to use, and things that look completely different. Not a single castle looks like anybody else's castle. The other part that was neat is that they all asked to be in teams, and I was thinking of it like an independent project. And they all asked if they could do it as a team. One fourth grade class gave up their recess to actually stay in and create a class castle. So that was really neat too, and everyone was able to have a part in it. So these are still on display till the end of this week in our library, and the kids are voting on their favorite top three to put in there. I did not want to vote because I liked them all too much, so I could not pick a favorite one.
So this is something we did over at Callum. So we did an extended research project on snowshoeing, the history of snowshoeing, how it works too, how you design snowshoes. We did this as part of their fifth grade social studies unit. So I challenged all of my fifth graders at Kellum to design a working pair of snowshoes using only materials they could find in their houses. So this is an example of some of the snowshoes that the fifth graders came up with. And I put on the website the kids testing out the snowshoes. So believe it or not, the most challenging part of this project was getting New England weather to cooperate. So I built a snow track for the kids, and this is them. This one was designed using old sleds. That one was designed using PVC pipe and rope. This one she used planters, which I thought was very creative. That's our winning design. So that was designed using that wraps around an outdoor garden, and she actually nailed everything together and used twist ties. We had many designs that incorporated the tennis rackets. This was a group of three that chose to work together.
I made a set of
So this is one of our participants telling us that she made the snowshoes out of and her testing them out. So she made hers actually out of hula hoops and duct tape.
Made of?
Planters and string. The string wasn't very straight.
Okay, give it a try.
One of the things we talked about is what would you do differently now that you have tested your design?
So, old sleds, winch cords.
So, old sleds and bungee cords. Give the track a try, Liam.
We discovered very quickly that sleds are slippery.
Okay, give the track a try.
These things called twist ties and plastic chicken wire kind of stuff that you put around the garden.
All right, so give the track a try.
So this is our winning design.
how easy she moved, maneuvers her way on the track. And the whole fifth grade watched, and you can see in the end them all applauding her. And I did a quick interview. So part of winning was that you got to have your design, you got to be interviewed on our daily news show called Killin' News Today. So she got to be interviewed on how she came up with her design.
Fifth grade snowshoe competition. For my snowshoes,
I made
my snowshoes out of wood, plastic stuff that you put around your garden, and twist ties and rope. I thought this would work best because you need a large flotation on the snow to keep you up. So I nailed the wood together and attached the plastic stuff on it, and then I made the straps out of rope. So I really had fun doing this, and I hope you enjoy. My name's Elizabeth, and I won.
So that is just a way that you can do makerspace at home. So I issued the challenge to them. It only took 5 minutes of class time, and then I kind of let them run with it. And they made the shoes at home, and then we tested them in the last 5 minutes before the bell rang. So just a fun example of a project that we did.
I think what she said to herself, she said it's just a lot of fun to do at home. And even parents coming in early with these giant castles and lugging them in were like, my kids had so much fun building it. They spent hours. I wish they spent this much time on other things that they were doing. But they're really getting themselves invested. I'm kind of going with it. All right. Oh, yeah. Are there any questions first?
One comment. I'm so excited to see MCBA is still in there. I am like really. I'm out of elementary school for a long time. So, and the participation in the Hour of Code and some of the things that you did in concert with that. That's so awesome that we as a district did that, and you know you guys put that effort in. The interesting thing about the teams, how you highlighted how in you know so many cases the kids even surprised you by saying like I want to do this as a team project. I think that's so important. I was interviewing college students for internship jobs, and we asked them questions about group projects that they worked on in teams, and they have some pretty nice makerspaces at the universities. But the thing they said, two different students commented that what they learned from, they had to learn and was important, was to trust their team members, because you're relying on the team member to come through on their piece of the project, and this is for kids that want to keep getting 4.0s in college, right? So this is really important. So learning to trust the team members and to be patient with your team members. So I think, you know, all the opportunity that you give students to do that in a way that maybe it's a more relaxed environment when they're in this makerspace. It feels that way to me. I think it's just really important. We don't realize, you know, how important that learning is, because you know every step along the way you're going to keep relying on other people, working with other people. So I think that's a great benefit. It seems of how the spaces are set up that they really engender that. I'm really excited about it.
I mean, a lot of the research shows that employers are looking for be able to collaborate and be able to problem solve. So what's more important is that our kids are not problem solve, and mm-hmm. We weren't sure how the teachers would buy in with us letting them, because it does look very relaxed, and it's very controlled chaos is probably a good way to put it. But a lot of the teachers, once they saw it too and how excited the kids have gotten into it, that they just kind of went along with it as well.
Great. I had a question. You mentioned that you went to see other districts and the cup stacking came of that. Did you see anything else in other districts that you thought, I really want to bring that to Reading?
I did. The Summer Street School Library, so they have a notebook that gives kids, a lot of times kids, when you give them free time, the first thing they say is, well, I don't know what to do. And that's what she has. She has a notebook of ideas, and then she even uses QR codes, so the kids can use a QR code reader, and it kind of brings them to a site that may get their ideas thinking. So I thought that was a really neat. I want to, you know, start a notebook for those kids that say, well, I don't know what to do. Well, you know what? Here's a good place to start.
That was something else that I thought of as you were presenting, is the different kinds of kids who would respond to this. I think you've got, I have two children, and I have two very different children, and one would really like this because it's so creative and this would be right where this kid would be. The other one is more of a, you know, a wonderful student on paper, but needs to have that creativity pushed a little bit. So I think for both the kid who would live for this part of the day and the other kid who maybe would be resistant to it, there's a lot of benefit from being challenged in this way.
And we did see putting a lot of like little challenges out. Like, so my after school classes, we had like a little challenge card. So this is your challenge for today, but you can go beyond it. The kid that couldn't quite get started has a starting point, and ones that want to push it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so you took them where they were.
Yeah.
That's great.
So very impressive. One, I did a little research on it when I saw the agenda, and one of the things that I've seen some other school districts do is real integrated into the, you know, let's say fifth grade curriculum, so the classroom teacher's involved too. Has that happened, or is that something that you see down the road?
Will next year. Yeah. So my snowshoeing project came, and my fifth grade social studies teacher came to support this presentation. We made it optional this year, and next year it will be required. So we thought it was such a phenomenal, and even the kids, the number one thing I heard when the kids were testing the snow track is, oh, I wish I did one too. So I've already talked to the science teacher, and we'll be working with the social studies teacher, and we will make, they're going to have to draw a design plan, kind of take it, you know, to the next level, and it will be required that they design their own working pair of snowshoes.
Excellent.
Yeah, when we talked about it in our PLC too, we were thinking this year kind of like the intro year. Get it out there, get people used to what it is and seeing how it can be used, and then the next step is kind of bringing people in. My art teacher already signed up to do a summer class with me on Makerspaces because she kept sending me all these ideas between Pinterest and other online sources. Like, we have to try this. Let me do this with you. So it's already bringing some other people in.
So this is the first year?
This is our first year.
Okay.
Yeah.
So a lot of progress for 1 year.
Yeah, I think better than we were expecting. We weren't quite sure. So it's been a pretty good start.
Good.
Thank you.
So the middle school poses some other challenges because we don't, I don't have scheduled classes. We're on a completely fixed schedule at the middle school, at least at Parker. Coolidge's schedule is a little bit different.
This isn't good.
Then the top one.
Top one should be it.
This one?
BGA, yeah. So I proposed doing Makerspace with my elective, my eighth grade elective that I teach. And we're using it in a variety of different ways. Some are similar to the elementary level, so it's the before and after school library hours that we have. The library is open before school at 7:15, and it's staffed by somebody until 4 o'clock, so kids have access to that. I'm mostly going to talk about the elective opportunities. Our elective is called Genius Hour because people didn't know what Makerspace was, and kids got the selection. They're like, what is that? I'm like, well, it's Genius Hour. They're passion projects. That's what we're doing. We also have borrowing options for students. So last year, through an REF grant, Parker Middle School got a couple GoPros that have gone out to some students overnight and over the weekend. And we just recently acquired some Lego robot things that I've loaned out to some students. Coolidge does some really great interdisciplinary projects during their teen time. They also have some enrichment periods where they're using the Makerspace opportunities. And our school has an after-school art club where they're doing all kinds of STEAM projects. And basically, this is what we used to start the Makerspace. I mean, nothing was purchased, like you said. These are all donations, or I'm a Craigslist shopper, and you know, sometimes you get free sewing machines if you look hard enough. Sometimes they work and sometimes they don't. But the only thing really that we've purchased for this, some duct tape, and I purchased a mechanism, a vibrating mechanism that, you know, you could get in cell phones. And I'll explain that. I have some examples, student examples. So Makerspaces, I don't know, these aren't, it's kind of dark in here, but Makerspaces look, there's some similarities to elementary school, of course. We don't have any fancy plastic tubs, so I just used the old paper boxes, and there are all kinds of donations. I went through my craft closets at home and stuff that we weren't using. Those are all organized. We have this large Connects area where really just last week I asked a sixth grade teacher. I knew that they used Connects before in some programming in sixth grade, and one of the science teachers said, yeah, I'm not using it right now. I'll send it all up to you. So this is a really popular spot. There's some books and how-to information. I've got this. This is just like a magnetic center where they're doing poetry. But this is really how I started off my genius hour. So kids took a multiple intelligences survey so they could learn about the strengths that they have. So we use that kind of as a springboard if kids got stuck with what should I do. So a lot of these projects are independent projects. I mean, they might be working with another person or a group, but mostly these kids are coming up with these projects by themselves. So a lot of these sticky notes that are attached here are all different ideas that some projects we've done and some projects, you know, just ideas for kids to be moving along. So you guys can see that really you might be in a studio in a makerspace, you might be working by yourself. This girl decided that her project is going to be learning about her really expensive camera that she got and doesn't know how to use. So she's playing around with lighting and stuff like that. These two are doing something really cool. They're taking apart old broken equipment. And these are a couple of teachers working after school with this girl because the sewing machine didn't work and I was no help. Even with my glasses, I couldn't see where to thread it. And these girls are doing something really cool. We recently had a Heroes Among Us assembly, and those two girls, there were a couple of other girls that worked on it too. They worked on the introduction video that was really superior. So these two kids up here are working, and I have a lot of examples, videos and stuff like that. So these two, believe it or not, so I teach this semester-long class. These are the only two kids in my class. We offer so many electives that I got two. So this was not an exciting group because there weren't a lot of combinations to go back and forth, but they spent a lot of time pulling things apart, and there's this plastic fabric that comes out of the keyboards, and she turned it into a wallet, which she didn't use the wallet, but you know, we were like, what could you use with this? These guys are using a whiteboard table, and they're actually filming commercials. So they would do their whiteboard, take a picture of it, and they turned it into a commercial. Ari here is our documentary filmmaker. He is syncing the GoPro with an app that he got on his device. So BYOD comes in very handy in middle school. And this young man, he and I work together one-on-one about three times a week, and he doesn't have a lot of background with technology. He doesn't have a lot of background with a lot of things. So I give him these challenges, and I see what he can do, and then we kind of work on them together, which is a great way to get to know him and see what his strengths are. So this cell phone projector project was the idea of one of my eighth grade students, and she came in with a magnifying glass and all of this equipment, and she said, I'm making a cell phone projector project. And I said, okay, so this device is supposed to magnify what's on her cell phone by 15 times. It didn't work. So she's retweaked it and she's worked on it again. I think I've solved her problem, but I'm not gonna give her the answer. I have some places I'm gonna send her to so she can see maybe what her issues are. So this girl right here, Rebecca, this Bristlebot. So we went on PBSKids.org, Chris Steinhauser, and I think you went Digital Learning Day at WGBH. So Chris came back and said, oh, you have to try this PBS Kids Design Squad. And the kids at first were like, I don't want to do that. It looks so elementary. And The design squad is really cool. You can do all kinds of, it's meant for middle school, elementary, middle, and high school, but it uses very simple everyday objects that you can find in your junk drawer, really. So Rebecca and Owen decided they were going to make this BristleBot, which basically is a lithium battery. The vibrator part of like a pager or a cell phone, and the head of a toothbrush. So I said, well, that's great, but we don't have any of this stuff. She said, well, if we have an old cell phone, I think that we could take it apart, and I think I could find the motor. And I said, okay, if you can do that. We took some thin clients apart. They got lithium batteries. I mean, it's a lot of work. So this is Rebecca. And I said, Rebecca, how do you know? So they know way more than I do. I said, how do you know this is the piece that you're looking for? So she showed me. And please tell me that's a link. Yeah. And I said, wait, say that again. So I had to film it.
So to test the battery and to see if this was the right motor, the directions said to test it to see if it worked, but I didn't know if it was the right one because there were a bunch that looked like that. So I tried a couple, and then this one, when you put it like that, it vibrates. So you can tell that one is the vibrating motor.
So nobody showed her how to do any of that. I'll always say to the kids, well, what do you think? And they're like, wait a minute. And they get on their device and they Google it to find out. Mm-hmm. And then this BristleBot. So what happened with this motor, unfortunately, they manipulated it so much that they broke the wires off. And they're like, I tried to put the wires back in, but now it doesn't work. So I did purchase some motors for them so they could use it. And then Jill, who's in my other class, took it one step further, and this is Jill's creation. She didn't cannibalize anything. So the next time, today she met, she just did this last week, and I said, can you get it to go straight? So she bent the bristles one way, so she's trying different ways to manipulate this BristleBot. All right. So we did a makey-makey. Rebecca did one first semester. She turned the staircase into a piano. This is actually a pretty cool project. So I don't know if you can see this very well, but this is kind of a hot mess in front of Parker Middle School right now, full of leaves, and it's overgrown and it's been neglected. So in the multiple intelligences, Alex said, you know, I'm a naturalist. She said, I like being outside. Basically, she's challenging me to come up with a project. And I said, well, oh, that's great. I said, what about that little area outside? So she went to it was really cold out that day. So she went to the principal's office. We took some pictures of it. And I said, now what are you going to do with it? She's like, I don't know. So she's into like designing, so she has all these apps on her iPad about designing. So anyway, along the way, I investigated SketchUp, which is pretty expensive, but I got a free educator one I put on my laptop, and when she comes into class, she's working on this. So this is her rendition of what it will look like afterwards. So on further inspection, there's this awesome granite bench there that says it's a bird, I don't know. It's a bird garden or something. I'm like, bird garden? Who would even know about that? Dave Williams would know, but he's been retired. So I said, okay, you need to contact Mr. Williams. I don't want to do that. And I said, oh, we'll send it from my email. So Dave Williams is coming back to help her with this, and she has a whole list of different kinds of plants that she wants to plant, and we're going to be looking into like getting a Home Depot grant and things like that. So this is a very impressive project that she's in the middle of. And we have a beautification day in May that she's hoping to be part of. Cole really just wanted to take something apart. So he took it apart and then didn't know what to do with it. And I said, Cole, you know, that looks like it's copper. I'm like, do you think that's worth anything? I don't know.
what's copper worth? I'm like, I don't know, figure it out. So he got on his cell phone and he figured out, we measured it to figure out how much we had, and then really, if it were copper, it was worth about 51 cents. So it wasn't worth his time, he realized, to start pulling all of these apart. And also I said, how do we even know if it's copper? He's like, oh, he looked up, you can, copper is, you can stick a magnet to it. But it's only a little bit, I don't know. So we determined that it wasn't copper at all. These girls, with the help of some teachers who helped them how to thread the machine, these girls are pulling apart old clothing and redesigning clothing, which is kind of cool. This girl right here is actually composing her own song. This is her composition that she did in GarageBand. So we have all of these tools, and kids, you know, they have a lot of interest. One of the things that came up when we were interviewing with the principals was this idea of middle school kids not having enough choice with what they study, and they like the option of picking their own projects and kind of working at their own pace and picking their partners. So although Grace works by herself on this, we've had other kids that have tried to change our new show's jingle at the beginning, and we keep changing things around to accommodate them. And there's also some coding that happened. Mostly kids will dabble a little bit in Scratch, but they're all experienced with Hour of Code and things like that. This particular group is not all that interested, but last semester we did go on Code Academy and kids were doing their own website. So this is actually something that they created in HTML. Basically they added text and they made it bold, and they, all of these names connect, they link to the blogs that students were working on. So it is, it's not live in Code Academy, but it does give kids kind of, some basics. And this one is really pretty amazing. So a sixth grade teacher last week who gave me the Kinects also gave me these Lego Mindstorms. And I said, where did you get these? He's like, I don't know. He said, I think a parent donated them. I'm not even sure where they came from, but we're not really using them except for this one boy right here. He said he comes in and he programs this before school. I let him take it home. Anyway, he said, you can have them for your makerspace. So I happened to see him after school one day, and I said, hey, Nate, can you show me this robot thing that you did? I don't even know what it does. So the next day, he played around with it. The next day, he brought two friends. And the conversation that these kids are having, this is Friday after school. The lights were out, pretty much. And they didn't want to go home.
Can you borrow the other one?
Is there a way to turn this? I mean, it's connected to this here.
Only if you programmed it. With the NXT program, you can. It's connected to
files.
So this kid, Gian's never seen this before, but he's like poking around and stuff. And on the way out, they were talking about, oh, you can come over to my house, and I have the little bits, and we're going to do this, and we're going to do that. It was very cool. And they were back this morning and after school playing around with it. So we got one of our... So Gian's thinking, and he's already redesigning what he's going to do. So today when they came in, I said, hey, what are you guys going to do with that? I'm like, are you creating that arm that comes down? He's like, yeah, we're working on it. So I left them.
Gio, what's the thing that's really cool?
Completely happy. All right. And this is Coolidge Middle School doing some origami. They donated a tree to Festival of Trees, and all of the ornaments were created by students in one of their enrichment classes. So I'd like to take this a step further and include more of the community. There's a lot of expertise in our town that we're just beginning to tap. And I've started inviting guest speakers in to speak with students. The Reading Public Library has great resources. We have a nice relationship with the Barnes & Noble in Burlington, and we have an RAF grant that's in the works right now. And today, our art teacher told me she has a friend at Intel who loves to, Intel loves to grant money to schools for makerspaces. I'm like, alrighty. So I'm just at the beginning stages of that. This is a sixth grade parent. So we are involved in professional PLCs, professional learning communities, are building professional learning community. Back in October, created a survey and sent it out to parents and basically asked parents, do you have any expertise that you are willing to share with students? You know, what is it? Are you available? Things like that. So this gentleman, Chris, is a cinematographer. He's a freelance film guy who edits film and produces videos and works a lot with Channel 7. Anyway, I contacted him because I have students in here. This, you know, you can't see this guy right here. This guy is our, he was in The Lion King, featured in The Lion King. He's a theater person and he just wants to be on TV. So these two connected because Mr. Fidali went to Emerson and that's his favorite school, that's where he wants to go. Chris was a theater major and he said, the message that he brought to the kids was amazing. Follow your passions, reinvent yourself, always learn things, all the things that we tell the kids. And Ari's in here. Ari is, making a documentary. This girl right here is working with the photography, so he talked about the lighting and things like that. We have Dave Williams coming in. We have teachers that work on sewing machines and other things. Here are a couple pictures. We had another art teacher who was an expert in textiles and stuff, and she happened to be in substituting in this room for a class. Anyway, Daisy saw what she was doing, and Daisy's in my class, and she said, can you show me how to do that? I really actually need to know that. So those two work together. And the public library has been doing tons of things with the community. So these are just some of the opportunities that they've given kids, and they work really hard bringing in high school students with middle school students and connecting kids together so they can learn from one another, and elementary as well. They have something called a library of things. This is a lending library, so they'll lend out these geometry kits and electricity kits and label makers and all kinds of stuff. So, you know, right now they're not in the greatest space, but they're really excited because when, I don't know exactly where this is in the library, but this is part of what they're going to have in the new library, and they'll have, you know, this makerspace area or innovation studio, and they're looking for input from the community to have some ideas. So you probably see 3D printers and things like that in here. They have a little bit more funding than we do. So this was something that Coolidge did back in November. They partnered together with Barnes & Noble. Every year they have a book fair, and it just coincidentally, their book fair landed on a big maker fair that Barnes & Noble was having. So they partnered together, Chris Steinhauser and I don't remember who the teacher was, social studies teacher at Coolidge. They read a book together, The Boy Who Harnessed the Wind. And the kids made windmills and they were testing them at the store and talking to people about what they had been learning about. And these are our grants. So Miles wants to borrow the GoPro camera and he's actually pretty expert. You might have seen him, Linda, walking around at open house. He was taking a picture of everything and everybody. Not sure how we're gonna edit all that. But really, the GoPros are on my desk, and kids, you know, can borrow them if they want. We have all kinds of sticks and stuff like that that they can, you know, selfie sticks and clamps and things like that. So they figured out how to suction cup the GoPros onto lockers, and they're catching kids being good in the hallways. And that's it. That's all I have. Anybody have any questions? Sorry, it was long-winded.
Just one comment. When you talk about involving the community, have you considered asking for donations to kind of help get materials, you know, coming up with a wish list and reaching out that way to...
I have really only just put it in the newsletter. So I've had a little bit of, you know, a little bit of momentum with that. But... yeah, I guess I could do a bigger push, but this was the first year, so it's our start, and absolutely we'll be doing that.
Right, and it's not even so much of like the big ticket items like a GoPro, but if, you know, like textiles or, I don't know, or old computer equipment or anything that people have, you know, kind of lying around, it's not
kids
monetary.
Kids took toys apart. It was, we got this really big donation from somebody, and the kids just went crazy with it, and I, corks, and we've used them for so many different things. They don't build a whole lot of stuff, like with the cardboard and stuff like that. I think they're doing that in the art class. These kids are really doing a lot of technology stuff. They're working with the iPads, and they're working with, you know, coding a little bit, the robotics. So it really depends on their interests. You know, next semester I'll get a whole new crop of kids with different interests, I'm sure. But they're a lot of fun, and the projects are really sophisticated.
I just kept, the thing that kept going through my mind is we're not in Kansas anymore. It just feels like what you teachers have stepped up to do is really respond to the interest and the needs of the students, really concretizing that multiple intelligence theory and enabling kids to be inspired and motivated, empowered through these projects. Robin, what you described, where you're responding to each individual student's interests, I don't know where you get your energy.
Well, it's, I can, because it's not, I don't have 25 students in the class. I mean, one semester I had two.
Yeah.
But this semester I have like 18 in the class. It's challenging. I mean, they're working on, I only highlighted a few of them. They're working on so many different things. Some days I'm just like, oh my gosh, the period's over. That's really the biggest challenge, that kids just get into a project and 42 minutes isn't enough for them.
Mm-hmm.
So we have a box of things. I'm like, just put it in your box. The box is everywhere. Put your name on the box. Nobody will touch it.
Yeah.
Sorry, Elaine.
So where are you doing this? In the library?
In the library.
In some corner or something of the library?
Corner, corners.
Everywhere.
There was an AV closet that... there's no, you know, there's no TVs on carts anymore, so
right. That
has all been cleaned out, and there are tables and shelves and things like that. So really the space gets reimagined all the time, and
mm-hmm.
just when you think you don't have another place to put something, yeah, we have a DJ station based on stuff that you guys have done, where kids can play their own music
mm-hmm.
from, you know, their telephones. So it's, yeah, you don't need much space.
So how does that work for you as the librarian? Then the library must be sort of closed when you're doing that class for that period.
It's not closed.
No.
So
kids
people
can still
in
come
the
in.
Lab. See, we have access to the library lab, so they're using some of those computers, but kids are coming in. There's small groups that are being met. These kids are going in all different directions.
Mm-hmm.
They're scattered everywhere in the library. And they're independent. It's eighth grade, so
mm-hmm.
they're able to do that.
Oh, so it's an eighth grade elective.
This is an eighth grade elective. We're looking into bringing some of this into seventh grade during like an enrichment block. You can't have 50 kids doing this at
right.
the same time, but you could have, you know, small groups of kids at a time.
I think there's some aspect of, you know, when you say you want to incorporate something in the lower grade, that you put a little bit more structure around it, sort of to the idea of the snowshoeing, right, where only it was voluntary and some of the kids
right.
participated and they really, you know, learned a lot, and the other kids are like, oh wow, I wish I had done that.
Right.
So I think, you know, you, if there's something that you can incorporate in the sixth or seventh grade that gives them a taste of what that is, that's more structured, a little bit more structured, then it would enable you to then leverage that to say, now you can take this as an elective, you're genius.
Well, Diane Davis and I, the woman who's doing the art art studio thing after school, she has done a lot of work with the Museum of Science. So she's actually, we talked about doing weekly challenges, and she's going to start them in her group, and then let's see it grow.
Mm-hmm.
So weekly challenge is open to maybe anybody. Not sure how I'm going to manage that with 600 kids, but I don't know.
I think the connections to social-emotional learning are really exciting, because so much of what we want kids to learn with social-emotional learning are skills that you have to practice. You know, you can't read a book and just learn, oh, I need to develop agency and learn to control my emotions. How do you handle it on a team when you don't get along? Or do you like working on teams, or do you like working alone, and why might that be? What are the pros and cons? You have to actually experience that stuff. So this is a wonderful opportunity in an environment where they get to choose what they're doing. So it's very exciting.
And I do push them, you know, Alex did not want to go to the principal's office to take a picture out the window. I'm like, come on, it's painless, let's go. She didn't want to do an email to Mr. Williams, but she did. I'm like, that's my job, to push you out of your comfort zone. It doesn't hurt. You can do it. Anyway, thanks.
Mr. Ryan, sorry.
I'm interested in awesome, you know, programming, though. You're doing a great job, Robin. But I was wondering, do you have a chance to see any of the STEAM activities?
Not exactly.
Yeah.
But that's because I'm not in Diane's room. She's doing an awful lot of stuff. I asked Doug to buy me a soldering tool. He's like, definitely not. But apparently Diane has one, and an electric drill, and some other things. So the spaces aren't joined, which is... It stinks for me that the spaces aren't close to each other. But so we're talking about how we're going to get the word out so we can borrow and share and make it more one thing. But it's evolving.
Great.
So actually, that's a really good transition to the high school presentation.
I'm so sorry. We have one more question.
I'm sorry. There may be other reasons why we shouldn't have a soldering iron, but really? I'm so like...
No, there are definitely reasons why we shouldn't. But no. I always push the envelope.
But I mean, just financially, this is, you know, I work up in Gloucester. They have some incredible makerspace. Now it's a different type of a makerspace, but it was really well funded. And I totally applaud. I'm sure what we're going to see from Sharon is going to be amazing, because what you guys have done here is built something totally amazing that captures kids out of nothing. And I'm sorry, it's just a little bit of my frustration about us always doing everything with nothing. Totally appreciate it. You shouldn't have to work so hard to do it from nothing, but we all learn more,
right.
I think, doing it in that manner. So hopefully in years to come, we will be able to much more effectively fund the things that you discover work. And, you know, thank goodness we have REF.
Right.
Well, that is a very good transition. You raised the question of space and funding. And so I want to touch on those things a little bit. This portion is called Making Space for Makerspace. And one of the reasons why this makerspace is trending now is because of that Web 2.0 or 3.0 ethos, which is create, collaborate, communicate, share. So much of the stuff that we're using is either donated or recycled or repurposed. Makerspace supports a smaller ecological footprint. And I think that's something that has been really on my mind this year and last year. My whole mantra this year has been reduce, reuse, recycle, repurpose. To this extent, over here is the kids are sitting at tables that used to be bookshelves. So we weeded our collection in the library. We've gone from a collection when I started here at the school 12 years ago, from about 25,000 print volumes to, I'm down to 3 shelves. And part of that is because we just don't rely on print the way we used to. One of the other reasons to go Makerspace is because of the kids. These are the kids who work in the library. Out of this group of kids, you can guess which one is the captain of the hockey team. You can guess which one maybe has dyslexia, or you can guess which one goes to Learning Center. One's the president of the student council. This is a really diverse group of kids, and this is who is in our schools. And I've never met a smarter group of kids or a group of kids more devoted to the library, and they've really taken ownership. So the high school has implemented new core values. We've just decided that they're respect, responsibility, commitment, perseverance, and scholarship. And so scholarship means very different things for all kinds of kids. Again, student investment, passion-based learning, these are the themes that you've heard constantly from at all of the levels. And it's really important that our kids are encouraged to follow their heart and to follow their passion. And when you think about it, the jobs that cannot be digitized and sent overseas are the things that are products of our imagination and our creation. And so it's really important that we tap into that stuff. This is Bella. Bella has a passion for sewing. And we've seen sewing machines several times, and I think there's kind of a new resurgence in it. This is a design challenge that she is starting. She's going to organize this. We're going to upcycle thrift store bridesmaid, a thrift store bridesmaid dress. I was out in Colorado over February vacation, and I saw a brown satin halter bridesmaid dress and a big long skirt, and I thought, this is, and it just sent me on this spiral of what this challenge could look like. We have a dress, a very beautiful blue silk dress that is all laid out on the pattern and pinned and everything, but it's just stuffed in a bag. And so the second challenge is to finish that dress, figure out how. And then the third challenge is to repurpose a size 12 velvet and denim dress into something that a high schooler would wear. Bella got out this, I brought the sewing machine in. One of the things that you've also been hearing all night is where do we get all the material? The first thing I did was go through every room in my house, take everything that I never wanted to throw away, but and knew there was a good, some could be repurposed into something nice, and then, and you know, brought it all in. And I have an email that is going to go out to parents asking you all to do the same thing. We're looking for frames, we're looking for tools. Either they can be gardening tools, because I was also looking at the eyesore that is out in front of the high school, and I thought, because some boys were saying, hey, wouldn't it be cool if we grew herbs in the library? And I think he was, you know, talking about basil and oregano and stuff like that, and that was because one of the computer companies at Blue Ribbon was giving out little seeds, potting seeds in pots as a promotional. I think it was HP. So, student investment. This is a table that this is Jack. This is Jack Bacon, and we have a beautiful table that we actually brought over from the original high school library that the Rotary Club must have donated, because there's a beautiful metal emblem in the middle of the table that says Rotary International. And it's been in, it was in the old library for a million years. Joe Kane and I both loved it. And we had it in this new library, but we had it in a place where you really couldn't notice it. And so these kids have been after me to redesign the whole back of the front desk where they all work. They don't like the way it's organized. They didn't like the sign-up system. And so in the last couple of months, our library assistants have been just redoing everything, moving stuff around and changing our policies and our processes. This is Jack, he's refinishing, and he wanted me to make sure to show you the before and after. Now, we started on the legs because we didn't want to ruin this beautiful table, but we're using a product called Restore Finish. It's $8.99 in Home Depot, and this was just, you know, like 5 minutes of work. You put it on with a steel wool. So, and he's into this. He's like, look at the difference, take the before and after. He's really committed to doing this table, and it's going to be beautiful. And every time somebody walks in the library now, they say, where'd you get that table? So as part of our PLC, it's been very, very inspiring working with the, working vertically as a PLC, because what you guys do in the elementary and the middle schools is something that I really wish we did more of in the high schools. And one of the things that I've been doing this year is going out to different high schools and seeing how they're doing makerspace. I went to Phillips Academy down the street, and I went to Linfield High with the PLC and Waltham High School too. And Phillips Academy is so into makerspace that they were given a $250,000 grant from one of their alumni. You know, that was a person. Makerspaces are popping up all over the place in Lowell, in Somerville. Now, don't worry, I'm not going to be asking for $250,000. Linfield did it with a grant, and don't quote me on this, I think it was about $8,000 that they got in funding. But my takeaways from these, of course the site at Phillips is gorgeous, but part of that $250,000 was beautiful parquet floors and walls that moved and taking down buildings and lots of like glass walls that you can write on and stuff like that. But what I would like to do is use the space that we already have. So my takeaway from Phillips was not, wow, I wish that we had a $250,000 endowment, but it was this beautiful code of the makerspace code that they had hanging up, and also what it was that we, what are the bare minimum require, or what equipment would make for a really good high school makerspace? And it's 3D printers, certain kind of software, a laser cutter, a plotter, which is kind of like a big wide printer that prints posters and stuff like that, some vinyl for the laser cutter, and storage. You need storage. From Linfield, it was the importance of collaborators and staffing, and why space and supervision is needed. So you need a big space, but it has to be supervisable. You know, when you're paying, this would be about, all that equipment, you could get it for about $20,000, but it also has a learning curve attached to it. It's expensive, you can't just, you know, say, okay, do it, you know, fool around with this, like we were doing with duct tape and fabric and stuff like that. This, you might not recognize it, this is our former computer lab, affectionately called Lab B, because it was in the back. But this is, now that the computers in this lab aged out, we do have the teacher workstation and we have a smart board, but what we really have is 714 square feet of potential maker space, if the math holds up. Some kids did the math for me today. It's very well lit. It's got glass windows, and it has a lock on the door, so the equipment and everything would be safe. The computers are on lap. We moved from desktops to mobile technology, so that's why that space is available. This is space where we weeded the books out. That's 432 square feet of potential maker space that's adjacent to that computer lab. I've been polling the students and asking them what we should use the space for, and where I'm getting things like quiet, believe it or not, small cubicles for quiet study, and small cubicles where we could do video editing and audio recording, and that taps right in with our curriculum. As I said, as I promised, I'm not going to, you know, go looking to asking my principal for all kinds of money. But John just yesterday or over the weekend alerted me of a Massachusetts DESE grant that the Department of Education is offering grants for about $20,000. There's an application process. The applications, I think this is, I'm pretty sure it's a planning due date of April 1st and then a later due date. Next year, if I would like to write another REF grant, there's a source of money called a Cummings grant, and then the PTO. And between that and what we're already using our library budget for, I think that we could do something really decent. Donations, old tools, frames, metal, paintbrushes, etc. That stuff is easy to get. I know that all I have to do is send an email home and my prayers are always answered. People want to declutter. They want to get rid of stuff and they want people to reuse their stuff. It's the right thing to do, and you know, I would like to roll that out with our core values of responsibility and respect for the environment. The other thing that I think is going to be important is to find partners in the community, and what I'm thinking is the person at Phillips Academy. Now they have 25 librarians on staff, so I know there's no comparison, but one of the things that stuck out was that the person who did their makerspace has degrees in design. She has a master's in design. So I thought, wouldn't it be great if we could tap we're used to getting library and people in from library school to do their internships and to do their curriculum with their practicums, but that would be also like to have another to have a graduate student with a background in design would be really wonderful as we plan for this grant the grants. I want to go back to one spot here that I think I missed. Pinterest and Etsy and open source. Kids are all over this stuff. Just like they were Googling solutions to the problems that they were encountering. Last year, I remember one of the best things that happened is to me as a teacher was watching this kid who had struggled all through 4 years of high school and not finding a place get so excited when she fixed our laminator. This is something that Joe King couldn't fix. It's something that we couldn't get anybody to. It's an old laminator. We couldn't even get a company to come in and fix it for like less than something like $200. But this kid jumped online, Googled the part and the manufacturer, watched a video that she found on YouTube and fixed it. And so that really got me thinking, I don't know if we have enough in our curriculum to satisfy the kids who learn better with their hands and by doing. We're certainly getting there. We've made huge inroads with the robotics classes and the engineering classes, and the popularity of those classes suggests that we need to be doing more. It's funny that I showed you two things that might take you back to, well, not you, certainly, but
you took me back.
Gary and I,
totally.
The sewing machines and
yeah.
The woodworking and there's just not enough opportunity for that. We have great art departments, and as I said, we're doing that in robotics, but I think that we need to start looking into our other curriculum at the high school level for more of these kinds of opportunities. If you go on Pinterest, people, and there are all kinds of ideas, and everybody shares it. It's not cheating anymore. It's not plagiarizing somebody's ideas, because part of the other Web 2.0 ethos is rehashing, mashing things up. You take elements of something and you marry it with something else, and you've changed it. And and people are doing that. And on Etsy, they sell their stuff. And in open source, open source, you can grab some of the software that runs those, the equipment that would, the plotters and the 3D printers, etc. A lot of the a lot of the products that you make are already designed. The software is already there. You just take it, maybe mash it up, change it up. Yeah, so that's where we're going with high school.
Really exciting.
I'm good.
Yeah, just the, I think twice, at least twice, people talked about, you know, you bringing in external resources, whether it's parents or a community. I think the other thing to consider is past Reading High grads that could be juniors, you know, or in their going into their senior year, and like studying design, your library, your design and layout, and just trying to connect with those students. I think over the last few months, we've received feedback from a number of students. Sort of, it was around the it was actually around the Coolidge Science Team acknowledgement of John McCarthy's passing. But sort of as a result of that, several students reached out in very, very powerful ways about how much they really wanted to give back. And you know, only a few years out of high school, having had the recognition that it was really just about one or two teachers who made such a significant difference in their lives, and that they really want to give back. So, you know, maybe there's some ways to engage with a student. And you do so much virtually now. You know, they can be here, but they don't need to be here. They can be virtually. Right, exactly. So, you know, maybe there's somebody studying design in University of Colorado or something now that would really, like, love the opportunity to try to do that. So I think it would be great, and I think it would be great to bring those kinds of resources to our students, as you talked about, you know, people coming in and talking to students. When we bring students into the place that I work, I always make sure we've got the young kids, the 20 some odd year old engineers, you know, not just the 50 year old engineers, to talk to kids about what interests them, what's cool, because what they find cool is a little bit different than what I find cool now. So I think, you know, trying to tap in, and, you know, maybe there's some ways that Lena can help with connections to students. You know, I know she's already done a lot to be looking at data and stuff in a different way, so maybe there's some ways for us to access those alumni and build an alumni network that would then help to fund great things in Reading.
You make a $250,000 donation for the Makers.
Some year, 30 years from now.
You know, another group that you were just chatting, Mrs. Webb, and another group I think could be interesting would be retirees in the community. I happen to know one who's an incredibly talented seamstress, and she would never think, oh, I'll call the high school and see.
Oh,
but if somebody reached out to her, I think she would actually be really interested in mentoring a young sewer. So that's another interesting connection to work through, maybe the senior centers and rec or other departments, to try to connect with people who are around during the school day and have expertise, and it could be a real win-win.
Mm-hmm.
I was thinking the same thing about the senior center, and our own Bill Brown is a finished carpenter, and a lot of the students, alumni from the drama department, learned how to use the tools and love it. And not all of them, I'm sure, have been able to go into those fields. So that might be a real draw
for
them.
Yeah, that is a big draw. I always say I wish I went to Reading High School now. You know, between drama and the set build and the carpentry skills that they're learning and everything, and the art, it's really inspiring. We have parents, students, just as we were talking about doing workshops, we have a bunch of kids that said, oh, my mom sews, she would love to come in, or my aunt sews, and they make these dolls. So it doesn't have to be just like clothing and tailoring and stuff like that, but rethinking what it is kids want to make. Puppets are very popular, like real, live, sophisticated puppets. Knitting and crocheting is really in style, and people are buying beautiful wools and making all kinds of things. So it's hard. I mean, one of the hardest things, I think that one of the things we were talking about is, what is this going to look like in the library, and how do we keep it a library and not just this, you know, place where there's just junk everywhere and maybe no theme or something like that. So things to think about. as we plan those grants. I'm glad that during the grant writing process, you have kind of an opportunity to think, well, where do we want to end up, and what would that look like, and where can we start? But I have to say, I'm really inspired with your curriculum connections.
Now, I found the whole presentation inspiring.
Good.
So I would just think that probably some more benchmarking would be a really great idea. I know I've mentioned Gloucester a couple times, but they do have great curriculum-connected makerspaces at the middle school, which is an innovation school. There's a couple parental parents that work in Gloucester. I know there's some Gloucester teachers that happen to do a lot of stuff with the 3D printers at the high school that happen to live in Reading and know some of the Reading teachers. But it doesn't have to be Gloucester, but I think you learned a lot, it seemed, from the benchmarking, and as is pointed out by the fact that you guys are collaborating with Linfield at the Blue Ribbon. So I would think, you know, some opportunities, especially at the high school level, to see, you know, how do you create that and connect it to the curriculum enough, because high school students are so busy after school, and maybe we have to move to before school if we change the start time. But at any rate, you know, I think it's maybe some more benchmarking, if there's some opportunities, would be good.
Anybody else?
Good.
I actually, something I was trying to think of just finally came to me. Thinking years back with Karen Holtzman Douglas and her Terabithia, and what she did from reading a class story called Terabithia, and then the kids actually built kingdoms and talked about the rules and the laws within and made all sorts of connections. And so when you were talking about the elementary school programs, it was making me think back to that and how powerful, because my son, who's now 26, still remembers that. And it really helped make connections, different connections between the students, which I think is really powerful. One technical question I wanted to ask was, I know now with donations, there are all sorts of rules that I never imagined for things that you might need, not necessarily machinery, but I'm thinking about take part things. Are there rules around what you can, like no television with things that will explode, but are there rules around what kinds of machines you might want for your take-apart stuff? And then the other question is around containers. Like, I know with allergy guidelines and stuff, can you recycle food containers, or what kinds of rules are there?
They could be contaminated. So I know, like, my maker challenge, I had to make sure it'd be okay, but there are things that are, like, glued together, and they weren't. And no one did anything in our, like, nut allergy to consider. When we did go to Linfield, they did have a taking apart station, but there they also had safety goggles, they had gloves to wear. We wouldn't, at least I don't feel like I would do it on an elementary level. I think I don't want to take that on for us, but older, it would just be going over some safety guidelines as we're doing it. I know there are pieces, we should probably talk to the tech IT support on if there was certain things inside of, I don't know what makes everything, so things that are inside of it that we'd have to be careful of disposing of or getting on.
Well, I know I had kids chomping at the bit to get their hands on computers to take apart, but there's, it's not a safety issue, but it's a proprietary issue. The school computers, what kind of information is on those hard drives, and other safety issues have come up. There's a very beautiful closet in the library, with high ceilings and plenty of space. You know, we're always looking for more space, but it's not zoned for human use or something like that. It's, you know, maybe, I'm not sure why. I think it was about ventilation.
Yeah,
and
the ventilation isn't.
Yeah. So there are things like that, and ventilation is also a concern. We were spray painting computer carts, and that had to be done outside, which is not something we would have really thought about, but, you know, we were talking to the maintenance. You know who is a really great resource in this community is Kevin
Gerstner.
He has been telling me about the different universities that I have to see, and he's got contacts at Wentworth, So we're going to take a visit over there. He works with drama, so he's really into the whole build and create. And so he always says yes. He never says no, we couldn't do that. He's very encouraging like that. Sometimes we find out we can't do it, but.
I just think the university connection is great too, then, because seeing what the kids, because some of the spaces that they have as you tour, you know, universities, college age kids, it's just like, wow, these spaces are unbelievable. For them to be creative and collaborative, media spaces, the hands-on spaces, they're just unbelievable. And so I think, you know, that's not what we're going to have here at Reading High, but I think, again, the more you can sort of bring aspects of that here, then when our kids get to college, they're going to be like, I know how to use that space. I'm all over that. I'm signing up. My group's getting that space, and we're going to deliver the best project, knock this teacher's socks off, because we know how to do all this already, versus, you know, what exactly is that? Oh, wow, I've never used that before. So that would be, you know, that I think that's a really important advantage that we have to be giving our students, and we've made progress with the engineering classes and some of the things that they've been able to do, the new science curriculum with the vernier, you know, so some of these more sort of hands-on lab things, but we have to go this step further. So I think that's great if Kevin's got some local universities for you to visit too, because it's just so powerful. It's awesome.
It really was awesome. Thank you so much. Do you need a minute to gather all of your made products? Yeah, why don't we take a 2-minute recess? Dr. Doherty, we're going to be discussing the NEC Collaborative Amendment. Can you kind of take us through this?
Sure. About a year ago, you approved the North Shore Education Consortium and the SEAM Collaborative Agreements, which are now required under the new regulations from the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education. All 18 school committees of the North Shore Education Consortium had to vote and approve that before we could start enforcing those agreements. So anytime a change has to be made, all 18 school committees have to vote on the change. And so what I'm asking you to vote on tonight is a fairly simple change that benefits the member districts, which we are a member district, and it's the elimination in the packet, it's the elimination of one sentence, which is non-member tuition and fee differentials should not exceed 10%. Currently, What happens is there's a cap that we can offer non-member districts on tuition when a non-member district comes in to use the programs that are offered by NEC. And that can't exceed 10%. But what we're finding is that is actually at an additional burden to member districts. And so by eliminating, originally it was put into the agreement because we thought DESE said we had to put it in, and now DESE's saying, oh no, you didn't have to have that. So there are some programs that NECA are looking at that they would like to have the tuition higher than the 10%. And so what this will do is allow NEC to charge non-member districts higher than the 10% cap.
So it's eliminating that last sentence?
The last sentence, yep.
That non-member tuition and fee differential should not exceed 10%.
Correct.
That sounds good to me.
Any questions or comments?
Move to accept the amendment to the North Shore Education Collaborative Agreement.
Second. All those in favor? 5-0. Thank you, Dr. Doherty.
Thank you.
I think Friends and Family Day is up next.
This is our favorite.
Yes, all I need tonight from the committee is, do you want to do this or do you not want to do this? We can talk about a topic at a later date.
Okay.
Because we just have to send the application in.
When you say a topic, you don't usually have a theme, do you?
Last year we did.
Yes.
Yeah, we did.
Much worse, because that was the big topic.
Right.
Yes.
Last year I had a wedding, so I swore I would put in a double shift this year because I wasn't there last year.
I think we need to be there with everything that's going on in the community. I think it's going to be important to be there. So,
actually,
we will.
But I was going to say, but to that point, last year because the modulars were so, it really affected, you know, everyone in the community, or a large number of people in the community, I think it would be important to try to identify a topic that's worthwhile.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like really to have a specific message or, you know, something that people can come and learn about.
So that can be maybe homework for us to call. I'll go and think about what are the hot topics coming up next year that we need to be discussing with the community.
I think we'll be fighting over which ones it'll be, but that's good.
There's a lot going on.
Yep.
So you just need from us today a commitment to the date. Is a general consensus.
June 11th, is that the right date?
Saturday, June 11th, 11 to 3.
That'll be wait.
Yeah. Okay. We don't need to vote on that.
Nope.
I'll put that down somewhere. So
we will be reconvening again tomorrow night at 7 p.m. with the Board of Selectmen?
Correct.
And I'm sorry, I forgot the location again.
That, I believe, is at Town Hall.
At Town Hall.
Oh, that's at Senior Center? Sorry, Senior Center.
Thank you. Senior Center tomorrow, 7 o'clock, with the Board of Selectmen. Does anyone have anything else?
Town Hall. I'll check.
I think that one's at Town Hall. I think Finance Committee's at Senior Center. But we'll check. We'll get that information.
Okay. And it's on the town website for anyone at home who's confused. Anything else before we go? Dr. Doherty, did you have anything else?
I do not.
All right. Do I have a motion?
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor? We're adjourned. Thank you.